As 2019 draws to an end, we're taking a look back at some of the stories we've brought to you this year with the producers and reporters behind them. The team of Sam Weber and Kony Cargbo spend a good deal of time on the road with the host of this broadcast, Hari Srinivasan. They sat down recently to talk about this past year and what's in store for 2020.
Kony Cargbo, Sam Weber, thanks for joining us. Happy 2019. Let's start with one of the stories that you guys produced with me, for me, out in the mangroves of Florida. First of all, how did that story idea come about in the first place?
Well, it was actually a collaboration with several other media outlets, including the nonprofit, not advocacy group, Climate Central. Mm-hmm. So it was a story that they brought to us, but it was a really sort of fascinating story of a plant that was making inroads further and further north because there was less and less freezes and less severe cold.
And we got to go out and watch the scientists work.
Absolutely, and I think that was probably the most interesting part of the story was being able to follow as the scientists conducted some of the investigations they were doing.
Each of these chambers is a glimpse into the future. By shielding it from the elements, the temperature inside is a couple of degrees centigrade warmer. By doing this, scientists can study what happens to the salt marsh and the mangrove in here at these higher temperatures versus what's outside.
What we see happening, at least in our first 6 months of data, is that the mangroves seem to be growing faster in the warming chambers.
The Wet Feet Project is a multi-year initiative funded by the National Science Foundation. Researchers pull water samples to measure data, including salinity.
It's kind of like getting blood from a stone, though, right?
They use Bluetooth-connected sensors to track environmental conditions like temperature and humidity, both inside and outside of the chambers.
Is this mangrove going to replace that marsh?
Likely, yes. Unless there's a deep freeze, it's going to overtop the marsh, and as it does so, it's going to shade out the marsh that's under it, and it'll just take over.
And this is somewhat dirty work. I mean, this is
absolutely
not the stuff that you learn in the abstract in a classroom. This is really get your hands dirty.
Absolutely.
And
you're walking through mud. You're walking in some swamps. But I think what was interesting was really following Hari to a degree and catching some of the moments where the mud seems to kind of take and hold of you.
Lost it.
Yeah, right. I had that special relationship with my boot, which kept the foot would come out and the boot would stay, and that wasn't very fun. You were also one of the first teams that we went out in the field and took the NewsHour Weekend program out to Houston. It was around a big anniversary that the whole country, the whole world was celebrating.
Yes, it was the 50th anniversary of the first moonwalk. And for someone who did not live through that period, it was really interesting getting to see it from the perspective of those who were alive and are now currently actually working at NASA.
And it was really hard to not get wrapped up in that, getting to see a control room that they had literally restored down to packs of cigarettes, coffee cups. It just really brought home what a monumental feat this was using the technology they had 50 years ago.
Right, because we have more in our smartphone now than I think what the Apollo 11, the lander actually had, computing power-wise, right? It's stunning to think that even in that control room, there were some of the projected images in the back. They were literally hand drawings of where this place should be. And we just take for granted on GPS, like, oh, well, shouldn't we be able to track X and Y? Well, not then.
And then being able to sort of catch up with a flight director today and the really incredibly tight timeline that they've been charged with to complete the next set of manned missions into space.
It was also really interesting getting to see some of the lunar samples. You know, we spoke with a curator there who's been mining these and being able to send these samples to researchers across the country. And to see these up close, to know that there are 2,000 samples behind some of these screens that we were looking at, that was pretty impressive.
And the way that they actually store these, how they transport these. I mean, at the first thing, you're like, these are just rocks. Oh, wait, they're rocks from the moon.
Exactly. what was also interesting was knowing that there's even more that we haven't seen, that they were just at the cusp of opening new vaults that would give us more information as to what information we don't even have about the moon yet. So that was great.
Now, one of the stories that you did is an interesting one about a slave rebellion that most people don't know about. What was this one about?
This was the 1811 slave rebellion. It took place in Louisiana, and essentially it was the culmination of many, many enslaved people coming together, planning to take over the plantations that they were part of, march to New Orleans, take over that city, and form a new country free of slavery. So it was really interesting speaking with the artist who was able to kind of trace this 30-mile journey to New Orleans, which obviously they never made that.
Right.
So it was a really great experience running along as these reenactors, 200-plus of them, walking from what was La Place, now in Louisiana, and actually making it to Congo Square in New Orleans.
And how difficult was it to get just that, even the reenactment?
It was really difficult because obviously in certain parts they were a little further away from you, so shooting some of those scenes were a little hard. But what was really fascinating was how detailed they got with some of the costumes. You know, this was 19th century clothes that they were wearing, machetes, muskets, and they really got into the details of what it would have been like to wear these clothes at that time period, and they brought it to life here in 2019.
Okay, and one of the stories you folks are working on that will air soon is about wind energy. But what's new about wind energy? What's interesting about it that puts it in the news today?
It's an energy that maybe we might take for granted a little bit, and maybe especially for us here in the Northeast where it's maybe not as prevalent, but it's a renewable source of power that in the last decade plus has really become a powerhouse. And for the first time this year in 2019, moving into 2020, it will overtake hydropower as the biggest renewable energy source in the United States. Hmm. It's really an industry that's gotten a huge boost from federal tax credits that are actually starting to phase out after 2020. So it's sort of taking a look at that industry and some of the challenges that I think both energy producers and policymakers know that they're going to face as we start thinking about how are we going to make more of a transition to a carbon-free future, particularly when it comes to power generation.
So where'd you go? What'd you see?
So we were in Texas, in the central part of Texas, and it's really interesting because that's part of the country that also has a lot of oil fields. So it was interesting contrasting this dirtier energy with one that's supposed to be the future for the United States.
Yeah.
And it's also one of the bigger innovations in this industry is that the turbines have gotten so much more efficient, and part of that also means bigger.
Yes.
So being on the ground at a project that's sort of just getting going, so there was basically 5 turbines up when we were there, out of 191 that will be built and online in 2020. And getting to see, for instance, these blades getting trucked in past us, I mean, it's really jaw-dropping to see the amount of infrastructure and the amount of logistical work that goes into even just physically getting these things to the place, let alone, you know, for instance, taking a tower segment off of an oversized truck and carefully placing it on the ground to be staged to then be lifted up.
All right, Sam Weber, Coney Cargill, thank you both.
Thank you.